Okay, so the second speaker is Wilfrid Kendall, and Wilfrid.
Thank you very much. This is the first time I've given this talk. It's a new topic for me, and I'm hoping that over the next few years the amount of material to talk about will be much longer. But I'm going to talk about Markov chain Monte Carlo optimal scaling and an approach which I think is quite new of Dirichlet forms, which I've been working on with my PhD student Giacomo, who is now at Bocconi, and with Mylene, Bedard, who was postdoc at Warwick and is now in Montreal. So I'm going to make quite a slow start to try and set the context of Markov chain Monte Carlo and the optimal scaling idea, and then go somewhat rapidly through the theory of the Dirichlet forms applied to the situation. So I'm going to start, I think, historically with a number of quotes of people involved in Markov chain Monte Carlo, and really the first quote ought to be from the Metropolis et al. Paper back in 1953. Wonderfully, they were running their code on the Los Alamos maniac. They don't name computers like they used to. And here's the quote. They thought this might be a feasible approach to statistical mechanics problems which are not as yet analytically soluble. Yes, indeed. And that's the Metropolis in Metropolis-Hastings, the core idea which is now used in Markov chain Monte Carlo. The Hastings refers to a statistician Hastings writing in 1970, and while I've been involved in this sort of thing, I've been told quite forcefully by many physicists that there's always a time delay. First the physicists have the idea, and then the statisticians come along, order of 20 years later, and invent it all over again. And we've been slow in taking this up, but that's to do with the fact that physicists always have first dibs on the first computers. This is a quote from Adrian Smith. I can't pin it down to any particular learning paper, but he was advertising specifically the Gibbs sampler, actually, not a Metropolis sampler, as you set it going, and then you go off to the pub, and you come back sometime the next day, and you've got your answer. A little later on, Charlie Gare is the person who first impressed upon me the importance of the Metropolis-Hastings idea, because it is so versatile and yet so simple to operate. He said, if you can write down a model, I can do likelihood inference for it, whatever. Very versatile technique. But as a counter to that, I remember hearing Elizabeth Thompson in Singapore back in 2004, and she emphasized to us in her course of lectures on Markov chain Monte Carlo, you should only ever use it when all else has failed, because it is computationally such an expensive thing to do, and so slow by nature. So, supposing you're going to have to use Markov chain Monte Carlo, you've listened carefully to Elizabeth Thompson, but nevertheless you find that everything else isn't working and you've just got to use Markov chain Monte Carlo, then clearly you want to make it work as well as possible. Let me give you an illustration of a problem that, in fact, Giacomo's thesis work was about, to illustrate the scale of a really modest scale, but still computationally intensive issue. This is work we did with John Blair of Queen's College, Oxford, a historian, and he conjectured that Anglo-Saxon place names, the names of villages in about AD 800, very dissimilar names, he thought they tended to be close together in clusters which had different names in the clusters. In some sense, the names were thought to attach to administrative functions which were clustered together in kind of proto-towns. And he wanted us to look at all the place names of Anglo-Saxon villages. I've got the dots here. There are a couple of thousand odd of them. And see if there really was evidence for that kind of clustering. And Giacomo used a model based upon a Bayesian clustering model, a sort of anti-clustering model, really, where you can get to cluster different things rather than the same, and came up with an answer which was our deliverable, resulting from about a week's run of Markov chain Monte Carlo. A week seems a long time, but this data has been around for 1,200 years and it's not going anywhere, so a week is relatively short in that time scale. I just wanted to put that up just to fix the thought that we're looking at things in principle. There can be a lot of signal to look at, and maybe not any one particularly distinct feature. The question is, this sort of problem, there are lots of problems like this that people apply Markov chain Monte Carlo to, how to do them well. Okay. So let's turn to the notions, firstly, of Markov chain Monte Carlo, a specific kind of Markov chain Monte Carlo, and the notions of quantum scale. The goal, if you want to be sharp about it, is you're trying to estimate the mean value under an equilibrium distribution pi of some function of your data, h. And the method is to simulate an ergodic Markov chain which has got that stationary distribution and use an empirical estimate, perhaps deleting some initial burning. That's what the M0 is doing in that formula. It's much easier to apply the theory that the chain is reversible, although that's not necessarily the best thing to do, but we'll just look at reversible Markov chains. A theory tells us under the suitable conditions you will get empirical convergence of the empirical estimate to the true mean. So there are questions that arise. How fast do you get convergence happening? Is there something like a cutoff phenomenon? Do you find that after a certain amount of time, the distance of the empirical distribution to the actual distribution suddenly plunges down from a relatively high figure to almost nothing? It's not coupling from the past method. But the question we're going to be looking at here is if there's a parameter in your Markov chain which somehow controls the size of the jumps that you're trying to make it do, can you tune that to get fast convergence? That's what optimal scaling is all about. So I need to be rather specific about the kind of Markov chain we're looking at. Metropolis-Hastings chain, I've written down a simple recipe for our Metropolis-Hastings Markov chain. You propose a new step using some conditional density based on where you are. You accept or reject the move depending upon the Metropolis-Hastings ratio, which I've written down there. This is easily justified from considerations of detailed balance for Markov chains. And now, you've got a lot of options. What's your proposal? Once you've fixed your proposal, then if you're using Metropolis-Hastings, you know what your accept-reject criterion is going to be. But there are various proposals you can use. The really simple, easy proposal is the independent sign, where you just continually propose from some fixed density to accept or reject according to the ratio. Well, actually, that can be extremely useful in specialized circumstances, although it's a restricted use of its own. What we will focus on is the random walk, Metropolis-Hastings random walk, Markov chain Monte Carlo. The proposal there is simply behaving as a random walk, or if you like, as a fixed density, but displaced by where you happen to be at the time. And then, the complex one, which converges faster, the large band Metropolis-Hastings or Metropolis-adjusted larger band algorithm, where you add in a drift based on the gradient of the density you're interested in approximating. Now, what I'm going to talk about is something that works for steps 2 and 3 here, but I'm just going to look at Metropolis-Hastings random walk algorithms, because that's where the theory started, and that's where we've got to working with the Dirichlet form approach. So let me give you an illustration to show you what the optimal scaling issue is going to be all about. If supposing that the proposal is going to be a multivariate Gaussian proposal in a vector-valued context. In fact, let's make it really simple. It's going to be a multivariate Gaussian proposal with a covariance, which is just a scaled identity. And the question is, what should the scale be? So there's going to be essentially intrinsic variance, sigma squared, for each coordinate. And I want to know, what's the right choice of sigma to get good convergence? So what's one going to do? You've seen one very complex example. There's no way I'm going to try and apply it to that situation. Let's talk about something really, really simple. Let's talk about a smooth target, and we're going to be interested in a high-dimensional issue to parallel the sorts of complex problems that I pinned up with the place names example. So let's do something we have a chance of working with. Let's do something, I mean, really, you'd never use Markov chain Monte Carlo for this problem, but let's suppose we're trying to simulate from a high-dimensional target density, which is actually giving each of the coordinates independently the same density. Okay, so it's stupid to try and do that, really. But it will be a toy model which will give us some insight into the sorts of things we can do. So, we'll have... there's the Python code for what I'm about to talk about, written out slightly greater length, you see. I put that in to emphasize the attraction of Metropolis-Hastings, that it's a really simple algorithm to use. Here is a target where it's actually proportional to e to the minus x to the fourth. So I just chose x to the fourth because it's different from x squared. Proposing with a Gaussian target would be a bit silly. We have a target is given by IID coordinates, each with that density. And I chose a scaling parameter of sigma I've written it here as tau equal to 1. I've done this 5,000 steps, and actually, the theory that we're going to be describing tells us this is way too large. It actually looks unsatisfactory quite a lot of the time. The chain is staying where it, the proposal's being rejected, so that the chain is moving. The acceptance ratio is about 1 in 50 proposals are being accepted. So, we should probably try for the smaller tau, because this big tau is making jumps which are so big that the Metropolis-Hastings ratio is very small, so the jump tends to be refused. Tau 1 is much better. Now the acceptance ratio has gone down to 76%, and you see it's moving around a lot more. So if tau 0.1 is better, then possibly a smaller tau would be better still. No. If we go to tau is 0.01, that's too small. Very high acceptance ratio, but that's accepting lots of really small steps which aren't doing a very good job. So there you are, for the benefit of Nick, who's just walked in. Hi, Nick. You have tau equals 1 is the scale of my Gaussian proposal for these Hastings. Too small. Sorry, too large. It's been proposing big jumps which are just in unlikely to satisfy the Metropolis-Hastings criteria. Oops. Tau is 0.1, much better. Yeah, you've got a question.
What exactly are you doing with the tau?
So, every time I'm in a place, I'm proposing a jump in 10 dimensions, which is distributed around where I am by a multivariate Gaussian. And tau is 0.1, then the covariance matrix is 0.1 times the identity. 0.01 is tau squared times the identity.
And then you take Hastings.
And then I use the Metropolis-Hastings proposal, and tau is 0.1. I'm quite likely to accept that change and do it well. Yeah?
What are you using to quantify the quality of your approximation by the occupation measures?
I'm using my emotional response.
No, but it's really
as the theory elaborates, you get a good answer to that question. But at the moment, what I'm saying is moving around the state space a lot better than the previous one. And when I decrease tau to 0.01, then although the jumps I'm proposing are almost all being accepted, they're rather small, and so I'm moving around the state space rather slowly. Now, at the moment, I have no theory that I've described yet to explain why really that's better, but the theory which, I should make this clear, it's a very classical theory now, gives you a meaning, a strict meaning, to say that really green is better than blue, and it's better.
Because neither of these figures can be properly as an outline as well.
Yes, but you're going to feel a lot better about this as I proceed. Actually, although this is good, it's not as good as it should be. Theory is going to tell us, in some strict sense, that tau is not yet small enough to get really good movement about, even though decreasing down to 0.01 is too small. Here's another example, slightly higher dimensions, 20. This is all about what happens as the dimension becomes bigger and bigger. So we're trying for a toy model which reflects some of the very large complexity you saw in the original PlayStation. And here, tau explained when it's clearly too large because it doesn't move for a long time to begin with. This is clearly not even achieving burning during a period of 50,000 steps now, because I've upped the number of steps, and the acceptance ratio is extremely small. Then I go to tau 0.1, much better. Again, we haven't really got a good criteria for what better means here, but it looks better. It's moving around a lot more. And if tau is decreased still further, then that is clearly looks too small. Again, if you permit this kind of touchy-feely approach to what's good and what's bad. So we're getting a clear, consistent theme here that in that really simple case, in the toy example, getting your proposal scale too big is bad, getting it too small is bad, and there's somewhere in the middle which is just right. It's what Jeff Rothenstein calls the Goldilocks principle. So here's the theory. Classic paper by Robert Scammon and Gilkes back in 97. We have a product target here, and my Metropolis-Hastings acceptance rule, we've got Gaussian proposals, we've got a fixed target, we know what that acceptance rule is to do, and for notation I'll have x under bar 0, the dimension is a super fixed because the dimension, the results are going to be asymptotic as the dimension decreases. I have x1 up to xd filling x0, and x1, I have x1 plus Gaussian increment times the proposal. So that's going to make a change if a is 1 and not otherwise, and so down the coordinates. That's essentially giving you a fairly complete description of what I have in mind based on your question, right? You can see I've got WI's my proposals, I've told you what the distribution is, implicitly you know what the acceptance rule is, that's saying how I move from x0 to x1. And the questions are, well, what's the complexity in some sense as d tends to infinity? Not going to measure upon that. What's the optimal choice of the sigma d, which was the tau I talked about before? It's going to depend upon the dimension, but what's the best thing to do here?
So, what's the dimension of your space of edges that you're trying to do?
The underlying dimension is d.
Of h.
H.
I mean, you're doing it for one function? I mean, the dimensionality of the shape of h, whether h is a polynomial, or the dimension of the space of polynomials as you want to get this right for, is going to have a big impact.
The next slide will possibly resolve, the next bit of the slide will possibly resolve your question, because this is the result which gives the frames what we're going to be about. What this is saying is, supposing we fix attention on just one coordinate of the axis, right? So, a sort of beginning to answer your question. I'm not telling the function, I'm saying let's focus, measure just one coordinate here. Let's risk our time according to dimension. Let's also alter the variance by looking sigma squared by d. And let's suppose a bit more about our target log density, my negative log density. Its derivative should be Lipschitz, and it should have these rather high level conditions here under the equilibrium distribution. Then Robert Scammon Gilkes showed that the time-scaled process with this behavior of the proposal scale as d goes to infinity converges to this set, which is a solution of the stochastic differential equation. And it's being run at a rate which is a function of the sigma I've chosen, which gives me the scale which the scale at each dimension via sigma squared divided by d. And now if you look at this, you can see that this is framing exactly the sorts of questions you want to be asking. We're not worrying too much about any function h here. What we're interested in now is how fast the distribution can be made to run. How big I can make this.
So that last bit is exactly constraining the vector dimension of the price of the h. The flat dash,
this
my double dash being under control. Is exactly
the same. Yeah, I'm glad you're saying that, because I objected to this as well when I saw this result.
Okay.
I objected to this. Second derivative, really, of the log density, but it seems bad.
But you will get dimension error. Anyway.
Yeah. So, I looked at this, and I... Well, how do they prove this? They use stochastic differential equation theory. They base it on results by Ethier and Kurtz in their celebrated book. And essentially all the research subsequently works on that basis. And when I got interested in this, my strong suspicion was this bit at least. There's really should be no reason for that. That's there to make the SDE theory work. And we ought to be able to get around it. However, before I move on, let's just talk about applications. Essentially, now this is telling us the right signal to take is going to be whatever maximizes S. Because then you will end up asymptotically with a diffusion which is moving faster, and then you can get a notion of complexity as well. So, here is what Robert Scanway-Jones went on to describe. Essentially, you can do simple math with the asymptotic proposal rate, acceptance rate, and show that the optimal sigma gives you an acceptance rate which is approximately 0.234. Actually, it's rather funny this. 0.234, I mean, you've got to remember 0.234, haven't you? This is such an easy number to remember. Everyone remembered it, and everyone then started working out exactly how to get an acceptance rate of 0.234, which deeply embarrassed Gareth, because he deliberately wrote in the paper that you shouldn't take 0.234 seriously. You should be aiming for your change to acceptance rate of about a quarter. But, you know, give someone an exact number and they'll try and achieve it. This is why I could say, make assertions before about the blue and the green and the red simulations. I was looking at the acceptance rate and it was off. So, although I was encouraged by the visual appearance, the theory was telling me, actually, I should be choosing that sigma to be around about a quarter. And in fact, if you make sigma around about a quarter, then you do see definitely more exploration going in. But it's a fairly crude measure, you know, quarter, fifth, third, you're going to get the same order of result. It's not going to be a big difference for you. The nice thing about this theory is it points you to a principle that you should be aiming for your acceptance rate not to be close to 1, Metropolis-Hastings, and not to be close to 0, but somewhere there in the middle, and a quarter looks fine. You could ask, even if you do something more complicated, is that going to work out all right? Now, there's been lots of work about this, which I shall very briefly summarise shortly. But let's just mention this gives us control of complexity as d tends to infinity. It says, essentially, you should, best case, be getting order d. It gives you practical information on how to tune the proposal. And the whole method doesn't really depend much on the phi. There's a central limit theory of time universality. Weaknesses. The convergence is of just one dimension. Well, actually, products that are observed. You can modify the results to say, if, for example, you get similar things for convergence for the first 10 dimensions, it would be nice to have an approach that looked for all of your dimensions at once. And there are very strong regularity assumptions, particularly this one, which Terry has already talked about. Now, before I start talking about Dirichlet forms, let's just note a wide range of extensions. Very shortly after this, Robert Rosenthal did the same work for the Langevin algorithm. The magic acceptance probability changes to 0.574, which isn't so memorable as 0.234, but actually it's really saying that between quarter and a half, you're in a good place. Bedard, they talked about non-identically distributed independent target coordinates. As that gets rather extreme, there are interesting phenomena that you can describe and categorize those. Freya Roberts talked about gives random fields. Mylene et al. Talked about infinite dimensional random fields. Roberts did something on Markov chains behind the cube. The interesting idea of adaptive Markov chain Monte Carlo, which is you can take your Markov chain and optimize it depending on how it's behaving on acceptance rates to get close to the magic range. Interestingly enough, and that's still not really worked out, at least when I talked to Jeff this summer, he gave a rather equivocal summary of this. It's already in practice, but in principle, if you do that, you can find your chain stops converging to the right distribution. All of them build upon the SE approach. So regularity conditions can disappear. Very recently, heard by Dermot Sattar is doing better. So, yep, I'm on time. I'm now going to overview for you how you can use Dirichlet forms to do something different. So, I'll review what a Dirichlet form is. I never actually went to a course on Dirichlet forms. I've read it all from books. Deeply conscious that some of you know a lot more than me, but here is the formal definition of a Dirichlet form. Bilinear form with appropriate conditions. Probably the best thing that I can do is to describe how the Dirichlet forms arise in practice for the two processes that we're getting interested in the Roberts et al. Formulation. So there's going to be a Dirichlet form obtained from the rescaled Metropolis-Hastings random walk. They've already done there. It's quadratic. It satisfies the requirements of the Dirichlet form. It can be viewed as essentially speeding up the random walk by rate d, and more exactly, it's the Dirichlet form attached to the Markov chain, which helps exponential holding times between jumps. And here is the Dirichlet form for what we hope to be. It's essentially an infinite dimensional diffusion of a not very interesting form, which is the limit of this form under scale. So we know the sort of result we're looking for. We want the processes to converge to this form. We expect the Dirichlet forms to converge to this Dirichlet form. What we'd like to show is that the Dirichlet forms of the top converge from the bottom in such a way as to imply convergence of the corresponding empirical estimates of the Markov chain Monte Carlo, thus to imply convergence of the diffusions that are represented by these Dirichlet forms. Okay. So, we're all about then thinking about how we can talk usefully about Dirichlet forms converging one to another. There are modes of convergence for Dirichlet forms. There's Galois convergence that requires these two conditions. So it's not quite saying that ENH converges to infinity H. It's saying something a bit more complex to do with limits and then source. And an improvement upon this, because this gamma convergence does not necessarily imply convergence of the corresponding random processes. But if you tighten things up a bit, specifically, if you tighten up the first condition, then you will get to that convergence. So allowing a little bit of dramatic tension here before I tell you what's going to change. That gamma 1 condition is going to change because we are going to make it stronger by allowing a weaker form of convergence of H into H. So they require something a little harsher here. Moscow in 94 introduced these conditions, and you can see the difference there and on to gamma 1. It's just a bit more stringent here. We require this hold whenever HN converges weakly. N2 is essentially the same as gamma 2. And the point of Moscow 94 is in that case, conditions M1, M2 holding imply convergence of resultant operators in the semigroups, and thus they give us the sorts of convergence we're wanting for the stochastic processes and for the empirical estimates. So now I'm going to really forget about the stochastic processes. What I need to show is that M1 and M2 work. I should say just a little bit more. There's some work by Sun more recently, which gives conditions for weak convergence of the associated processes, which is this solid time inequality. Not going to major upon that, but that is in that paper. Okay. So I've told you about Dirichlet forms, and I've told you what we need to prove in order to get the result we want. We have to take those two forms, the ED and the E infinity. We have to show ED converges as D tends to infinity in a Moscow sense to E infinity, then we're happy pretty much. And the interesting question is, what are the conditions we require on the phi for that to work? So I'm going to give you our first shot at an answer for that. Here it is, and I put in red the regularity conditions we do require. So you'll see essentially everything is the same as for the Rogers, Gellman, Jilks results, except we do not require second derivative information upon the negative log density. Instead, we require what? Well, a Holder condition on it and a sort of polynomial growth of the differences as well. I'm not sure, in fact, I'm fairly sure this is not the best possible condition we can get here. But we've certainly got rid of the second moment here, and we've also got rid of the Lipschitz condition on phi prime. In that case, we get Moscow convergence. We can do a little bit more at a price. If phi prime is globally Lipschitz, I don't like that it's globally Lipschitz, but that's what we need in order to make it work at the moment, then we can apply the Sun result to show the corresponding scale processes exhibit weak convergence. That's weak convergence of infinite dimensional processes, so that might be why things are having to be stringent. I'm just not sure about this. There's quite a lot I don't know. Let me talk about the method of proof. So there are three bits of this, and the computational engine really is a central limit theorem result. We'll look at the Metropolis-Hastings acceptance ratio, look at its logarithm that's written out in the terms of the negative log potential that way, that converges weakly to a normal distribution, weakly in the sense of when we condition on the values x of where the process is. And we can use this to deduce the asymptotic acceptance rate of the random walk sampler, so essentially the Goldilocks phenomenon comes exactly from this asymptotic distribution of the acceptance ratio here. That's what makes it all work. Key ideas to try and maintain some respectability is still being able to cut the hard stuff. I need at least to try and summarize it for you. How does it work? Take that log acceptance ratio there, write it out using first order Taylor series thus, and then conditioning implicitly upon x for the first 2.5 steps, rather trivially, the first term converges weakly to the normal distribution of its centered form. not really a central limit theorem in any reasonable sense of the act, because the normal bit comes automatically, and then the rest of it is to look at the second side and show its variance tends to zero, that uses the regularity conditions upon phi prime. And Hoeffding's inequality, then taking absolute expectations rather than conditioning, shows that the mean converges to the right value for the mean in order to get the result we want. Okay, that's cool. That's about 3 pages of rather tedious analysis, which I just described to you in a very high overview, such that any one of you could reconstruct our argument by this, I suppose. Okay. Now I need M1 and M2. This is very encouraging. It's clearly saying, you know, we're getting the Goldilocks principle coming out again, but we need that convergence of Dirichlet forms to be strong enough to give convergence for the processes, and for that we need M1 and M2. M2 is really easy to establish, so I'm just discussing this. This is the one we deal with first. It's sufficient to consider the case where the limiting form is finite, because otherwise the required thing is trivial. Approximate the smooth cylinder functions with what you might call complex cylindrical support. Using smoothness, show that we get appropriate convergence of EMs as M tends to infinity. Take subsequences, you get the result. This is not a big deal. M2 is rather harder. And just in summary, what does one do? Define a function, and it's the expectation of that psi dh squared, which is the ED form. Integrate against a suitable test function, both of x and w, of complex support. Apply Cauchy-Schwarz, and then, in a single sentence, I am free. This conceals, of course, a great deal of detail, using integration by parts. So quite a challenging analysis for us, conditions on the phi prime, why is that going to be? So that's basically given the shape of the proof. And actually, I'm now moving to a close, because what's my conclusion here then? I've shown you get the Moscow convergence of Dirichlet forms that implies that you can get convergence of the random processes, at least finite dimensional sense, that's enough to show you're getting convergence to the equilibriums you seek. A little more work with slightly more stronger conditions shows you get the weak convergence. So this allows for significant relaxation of the conditions required, as we do from the Dirichlet form theory. There's almost surely more that can be done. What we've done is a first shot. I'm sure we can do better in relaxing those conditions. I showed you all that work on all sorts of generalizations. It's apparent that the phenomenon expands beyond IID requirement targets, and the question is then, can you relax those conditions to make sense in those situations? Could analogous things be applied for discrete Markov chain cases? And what might this have for to say for adaptive Markov chain Monte Carlo? Yeah, that's a pretty good 10-year research program, so I think I ought to stop here.
I'd like to go back to the original question. The original question is that one has some measure that one's trying to